It's October, time for postseason baseball, and here's Mr. October, Reggie Jackson. He was here a few weeks ago. We talked about George Steinbrenner and Billy Martin and some of Reggie's thoughts about his own image. Now we're going to talk specific baseball situations. You hit well over 300 in playoff and World Series competition, a slew of homers in that situation, including your single most memorable night, the sixth and final game of the 77 World Series, where you hit homers in three consecutive at-bats, in each case off the first pitch. What do you remember of that night?
You know, it's just funny. I was just going over that a couple nights ago with a guy, and I remember the entire day. I always hit last when I was with the Yankees, and I just found out a couple years ago that the big hitters that put shows on hit last in teams' lineups. And that day, I hit from 640 to 645, and at that time, there were about 40,000 people in the stands and 150 to 200 media, and my team's on the field, and the Dodgers are ready to take the field, so they're sitting on the side on third base line, ready to take the field. Dick Houser was throwing batting practice to me. And during that time, you get about 50 swings, and I probably hit 30 balls in the stands. And in right center at the 407 mark, which it was at that time, I hit probably 8 to 10 in a row, just carbon copies like they were coming out of a copying machine. And then in the third deck in right field, I hit 7, 8, 9 in a row, and they were just shot out of a cannon. And when I finished batting practice, I got a standing ovation from the crowd. And I can honestly say that when you finish batting practice, you usually take a lap around the field, a lap around the bases, or circle the bases. I felt like it was about 6 inches off the ground. I had a great day that day, had lunch, spent time at the house with a lady friend, had fun all day long, and left for the ballpark. I remember leaving for the ballpark at 20 of 3. And drove to the ballpark, and I happened to drive my Volkswagen to the ballpark that day. I had a blue one.
Reggie in a Volkswagen?
But, well, I had times when they were scratching my car and there were so many fans and everything that I got a Volkswagen from, in fact, my agent, Mac Marola, got it for me from somewhere in Queens or something. But it was easy. It was a blue one to get around. But then during the game, I remember hitting and or coming to the plate, and I felt so good that I just said, please throw me a strike. If I just get a strike, I'll be all right. And Hooten went around me in the strike zone, first four pitches. And that was because of the BP I had, I felt. I had such a good BP, he didn't want to give me a ball or hit. The next time up, I said to myself, I know they're going to pitch me in, so I'm going to lean over the plate with my upper body, but stand 6 inches away from the plate to try to disguise it, because they would recognize if I moved. And I made a ball that was on the inside part of the plate where you could get me out. I made it down the middle and made balls off the plate inside mm-hmm. strikes from me. Because when you pitch a guy perfectly, you pitch him in or off the plate. That's why when they hit hitters, you're supposed to hit them. Because if you miss inside, you're supposed to miss at the hitter, not on the plate where it's, you know, home run. The first pitch he threw me was a fastball inside. It was right where I wanted it. I hit it out of the ballpark.
There's a drive to right field indeed. Smith going back, away back. It's gone. Home run, Reggie Jackson.
Next time I came up, they brought in Sosa. And when he was coming in, I said to myself, this guy's a fastball pitcher. He's got the same scouting report on me. He's going to pitch me inside because he's going to say Hooten didn't get it where he should have, and I can get it there. And I said to myself, just please God, let him throw me a strike. And he threw a strike.
Sosa set. The pitch. Drive to right field and deep. Way back. Going. Gone. Another home run for Reggie Jackson. And the Yankees lead 7-3.
And then the last time I came to the plate, I was sitting in the on-deck circle. They were changing pitchers, bringing in Charlie Huff. And as soon as I went to the plate, I couldn't lose. I had two home runs. The fans were going crazy, hollering, Reggie. I think I had four home runs at the time, and it tied the record. It was pretty obvious that we were going to win. And they brought in Charlie Huff, and I said to myself, I've got like 10 or 12 homers lifetime off Wilbur Wood. I can't believe I got three or four homers off Eddie Fisher, like four or five off Hoyt Wilhelm, and I couldn't believe they were bringing in a knuckleball pitcher. And he threw the ball, I mean, it was room service.
Jackson with four runs batted in and sends a fly ball to center field and deep. That's going to be way back, and that's going to be gone. Reggie Jackson is in his third home run of the game.
What were you thinking after the third home run as you rounded the bases? Only one other man has hit three home runs in a World Series game. Babe Ruth did it twice.
Well, I can tell you that I didn't know that at the time, but I did feel like I was like 6 inches to a foot off the ground when I was running the bases. I was really happy. My father was in the stands. My sister was in the stands. I knew my mother was watching. She had a heart condition and she couldn't come to the game. And I just felt tremendous vindication because I'd really had a tough time all year long. But I felt finally that I had proved to everyone that George Steinbrenner had made the right decision.
What did Billy say? Now, earlier that season, in 1977, you had nearly come to blows with him in the dugout at Fenway Park when he yanked you from a game you felt you hadn't hustled on a pop-up. Elston Howard stepped between the two of you. Now, just a few months later, here's Billy on the top step embracing you like you're his younger brother. What did he say?
You know, I don't remember what he said because there was so much going on at the time, but I feel in my heart, and if I can remember back to the situation of looking at him when I came down the stairs, that he and just about everybody there that I can remember was truly happy for me, and more than that, happy because we were going to win the world championship. And I really think Billy Martin didn't have a malicious bone or feeling or uncomfortable, distasteful, angry feeling toward Reggie Jackson at all at that time. I really don't.
You know, outwardly, I think Billy and maybe you at that stage in your life thought of each other as opposites. I think consciously Billy said, I'm a scrapper who didn't have much talent, and I had to claw for everything I could get, and I'm an infielder who wasn't powerful, and he's an outfielder who is powerful, and I came from a different era in baseball, and now he's in the big money era. And yet, while all that's true, essentially, you had more in common, in my view, than differences, because each of you, for different reasons, was always looking for vindication, always looking to get what was worthwhile in your own minds and what was the passion and what you thought was the essence of your baseball soul out there and get it over whatever insecurities bothered you. I thought you were brothers under the skin.
I would agree with you. I believe that Billy Martin and Reggie Jackson had more in common than they had than they were opposites. And I'll just leave it at that. I thought then that it was very sad that we didn't get along and have a friendship, because I think we would have owned the city together.
1971 All-Star Game. That was another. The homer off the light tower on top of the upper deck at Tiger Stadium. You were just a young player then.
I can remember ordering a bat. I changed bats at that time and went to a model produced by Adirondack, and Joe Torre's brother, Frank Torre, had made a special bat for me with a handle and a certain weight and a certain length. It was 35 and a half inches long and 36 and a half ounces. And he had brought about seven different bats, and they were within a 64th of an inch in handle and difference. And he said, pick out the one that you sent me, because he didn't believe it, that I could do that. And I picked out the one, and he said, you're right, that's the one that's a 64th of an inch in difference. I said, I like this one. I'd like you to make them all like this. And I remember Earl Weaver calling me to pinch hit, and it was early in the ball game. I was an alternate on the All-Star team. Tony Oliva hurt his knee, and I was selected as the alternate. And when I got dressed to go to the All-Star game, Sal Bando said to me, he said, Buck, which was my nickname, he said, Buck, don't punch out, will you? Just don't embarrass the team and strike out, because I obviously have a reputation of striking out. So he called me like in the second or third inning to hit for Vita, and I said to myself, Jesus, he must be wanting to get me out of the way. He's hitting me so early. He hit the stars late. So I hit early in the ball game for Vita, because Vita was getting hit hard, and Doc Ellis had to count a ball and two strikes on me. And so I got back out of the batter's box, and I choked up, first time in my life, like about a quarter of an inch to a half inch, because I said to myself, when I got out of the batter's box, I know Sal thinks I'm going to strike out. And to keep from striking out, I choked up a little bit, and Doc Ellis hung a slider. I mean, just a nothing, which is kind of a lazy fastball, mm-hmm. which is a bad slider. And hit the ball right on the button, and bingo.
Long drive, deep
now around third base.
I asked Ted Williams this once. What does it feel like the instant you hit a baseball as well as a baseball can be hit?
Wow. I would say to try to put it into people's understanding, it's everyone plays golf. And it's like hitting a perfect one iron or a perfect two iron or a perfect driver. When you hit the ball right on the sweet spot and when everything is down and extended, you know that it all happened right. And when the ball leaves the bat or leaves the club head, you don't really need to look. You can throw everything down, take off your jacket, and really step back away and say, look, everybody, look what happened.
Back now with Reggie Jackson. We left off talking about the 71 All-Star Game, one of the most amazing All-Star Games in history because it straddled the eras. Yes, you were in that game, and Vida Blue and Sal Bando, who played with the great Oakland teams. But in that game, Willie Mays, Roberto Clemente, Hank Aaron, Frank Robinson, Johnny Bench, Brooks Robinson, Lou Brock, it's like half the Hall of Fame was in that game. Yeah. And it was your greatest moment outside of World Series play.
Right. Killebrew was there. Gibson was there.
Rod
Carew was there. Anybody that was anybody. Joe Torre hit 363 that year and won the Most Valuable Player award was there. And it's something I'll never forget. I remember the balls that Aaron and Clemente hit to the right in the right field bleachers in the same way with Johnny Bench. And I remember talking to Johnny Bench, you know, like kind of like, here we are again. He and I were kind of American League, National League rising stars, so to speak. And it was neat. I always remember being around those guys. I remember balls that Willie Stargell hit. He's a Hall of Famer. He was there. And he hit balls in the second deck in Detroit like he was standing at second base when they hit. It was like they were starting to go up or they should have went another four blocks. I mean, it was amazing. He looked like a guy that was about 8 feet tall playing in the lobby of a hotel. You know, he was amazing.
Here's the reason why I brought this up. From our past conversations, I know that you have a better sense of baseball history than many modern players do. And when you were moving up the home run list and passing Ernie Banks or Ted Williams or Mickey Mantle, you always expressed an appreciation of their careers and a respect for being in that kind of company. So I wonder how it made you feel when some of the older players who didn't approach the game the way some modern guys do used Reggie Jackson as an example of something they'd never do. I'd never drop the bat and look at my home run. That would show the pitcher up. I'd run around with my head down and that'd be the end of it.
Well, there were guys that were like, that would tell me those things. I remember Harmon Killebrew, who was a sedate, very quiet guy that, you know, very had an image of being, you know, a classic guy, hit a home run and ran around the bases. And toward the end of his career, we started having conversation. And he told me that he enjoyed watching me because he would never do the things I did, but he enjoyed coming to play against Oakland because Reggie would do something exciting or something crazy, I guess. Some players, and I've heard some of the older players say, in talking to them, I can tell that some of the older players were jealous of Willie Mays because Willie would go 0 for 4, steal a base, make a basket catch, make a throw, score a run, and not get a hit. And overshadow everyone else because of his charismatic, flamboyant, flashy style of play. He had people resent his style of play. You know, I don't think there's, you know, anything wrong with it, but I think that, you know, Bob, for me, I think that many of the older players recognize the fact now that Reggie Jackson knows who they are. And I think they're impressed by it. There isn't any one of the great stars, Banks, Mantle, DiMaggio, Williams, Mays, Aaron,
that don't like Reggie Jackson. And I think that the sad thing today for a lot of the great players is that they don't recognize the older players, that how great they really were. We were talking on the way down to the show today that Lou Gehrig had 4 years with 170 or more RBIs.
Mm-hmm.
The years, you know, Aaron had 2,200 RBIs. That's 100 a year for 22 years. And I remember doing a show with Ted Koppel. Bo Jackson had mentioned that he didn't even know who Buck Leonard was. Well,
great Negro League star.
Well, Bo, you need to know those things, and you need to appreciate these players and recognize that they did pave the way for the to let Reggie Jackson make $1 million a year and to let you make $5 million a year. And you need to remember them. And that's all they ask.
When you go into the Hall of Fame, will you wear an Oakland uniform or a New York Yankee uniform?
You know, I've heard that question gets asked to me quite a bit. I had some problems in Oakland a couple years ago, and they have been ironed out. And I guess I'm leaning toward Oakland, although I lean toward the Yankees a year ago, probably because I live in the town. But I don't know. I guess I'm looking for an excuse and for someone to give me an excuse where what hat I should wear. I don't have one right now.
Just to clear up the confusion, obviously, you don't dress up in the uniform. You're in there in jacket and tie when you're making your speech on the steps at Cooperstown. But there's a representation of the player on the plaque. And seldom has there been a player where it was so clear. Lots of Hall of Famers have played for more than one team, but in almost every case, they made their mark on history most with one club or another. In your case, it's almost split down the middle.
Mm-hmm. I don't know. I'll wait. I have some time. The biggest hurdle is to get into the Hall of Fame, and I think that'll be a wonderful problem to have. I don't have a baseball organization right now where Reggie Jackson hangs his hat. And if it is Oakland in the future or it is New York in the future, then that most certainly will make it easy for me.
Since this is October and we're talking with Mr. October, one more moment. 1978, the classic confrontation with Bob Welch. He got you on strikes in that second game at Dodger Stadium, although it should be said that later in the series you hit a home run off him and the Yankees came back to win the whole thing. But what I'm interested in here is not so much the outcome, but the pitch-by-pitch process that led up to it. What do you see and hear at that point? Do you hear the crowd? Are you aware of people around you? What's going through the hitter's mind in a situation like that?
What was going through my mind was, and would go through my mind in all situations like that, that are game-deciding situations, I call it, when the game is in balance. No matter what you do, no matter where you stand, no matter what you think, you must get the barrel in the pay zone, which is getting the barrel of the bat is about 12 to 18 inches. You got to get that barrel up in this area a little bit in front of the plate to be able to collect your dues or to be able to, in the pay zone, to make something happen, Bob. And I give him credit because he kept the ball in an area where I couldn't really get to it. He had the ball in here on me where I needed to hit the ball out here to make me hurry some, and I needed the ball out here where I could have got it back.
The pitch, swung on, and Milt Jackson goes down swinging, and the ball game is over. The Dodgers charge out on the field, hugging rookie Bob Welch.
Could you see his eyes? Did you say to yourself as you stood in there, now wait a minute, sure there's a pure pitcher-hitter game, but there's also a person-to-person game. This is a 20-year-old kid. We didn't know that Bob Welch would develop into a 20-game winner. He's a 20-year-old kid. I'm already the guy they call Mr. October. I hit 5 home runs in last year's World Series against this same team. I'm made for this moment. This kid might very well be wetting his pants.
That's all true. I looked at him as a guy, a hired gun that came in to gun me down, the gunslinger, the black hat guy. I was a black hat guy, and he was the white hat, you know, young kid. And I didn't look at him as I'm Mr. October and he is a fledgling going to make his name on me. I looked at him as a guy that was a specialist that came in that threw harder than anybody around at the time, at least anyone on their staff. However, I felt that he would not be able to handle me in that situation, that no matter what he had, if he was just going to come at me time after time with fastball after fastball, he was going to lose. I was going to win the battle. have a little something for you. Since I work for Upper Deck, I want you to know that you are have been selected. I told them I'm supposed to pick all the future stars and all the future Hall of Famers, and so I want to let you know that I told them that they should take you, and this was the picture I said to use. This is your action shot.
Right, exactly. That's this is the pathetic story of my life, ladies and gentlemen. These would be Reggie's action shots right here. Angels, A's, and Yankees. And for me, donning a golf sweater is about the epitome of physical action. This is an action shot
you
of me.
You could have a mic, and you could be like that. And
yeah.
That'd be an action shot.
This was great. Thanks very much.
You're quite welcome.
Okay.
Thank
Mr.
You.
October, Reggie Jackson. We'll have him back again sometime. Hope you enjoyed this one, and we'll see you later.
Bob's guest tomorrow will be comedian Jerry Seinfeld.